Yes, a very good morning. Right, some of you have also wished me Vanakkam, ma'am. Right, so Vanakkam also. Right, so I hope all of you have looked into the entire chapter of ethics yesterday, professional ethics. You've gone into all the 34 clauses of ethics, the sections of the Chartered Accountants Act, probably also done some writing practice, right, regarding how the answers of ethics are required to be written in the exam. Right, yesterday I came across, before I come to the revision point of today, that is CARO 2016, yesterday I came across one particular methodology, which I could call it as, which can be used by the students while they are studying a theory subject. So, you know, the book mentioned that one subjects are the do subjects, like FR, SFM, these are the subjects which you need to do. And then you have the audit law where you need to read the subjects and then later on you need to do the writing of the subject. So there they talked about a methodology regarding how to study, how to read a theory subject, right? And the technique or the methodology is something called as PQRST, right? Are you all listening to me? Right, so before going to the discussion on CARO, to the revision of CARO 2016, I thought probably I could just discuss or, you know, share this with you, right? A technique called for reading of the theory subject called as the PQRST. Right, so I hope everybody knows what am I talking about. Okay, right, so the P in that technique of PQRST stands for preview. It says any chapter, any topic, you know, in which you are starting to study, first you need to preview that chapter. Yeah, that is, look into the headings, look into the subheadings. It's like, you know, trailer regarding what all is included in this particular chapter. That is the P for preview. Then after that, it says Q stands over there for the questions. So all the headings, subheadings which you have seen, you think of what could be the possible question which could be made out of this, right? And say at the end of the chapter also a few questions would have been given, right? So you look into the questions, what could be the probable questions. So first P stands for you preview the chapter. Next Q stands for you think of the questions which could be formed from the different headings and subheadings of the chapter. Right, then after that we come to the R. R is now the reading, right? So reading, effective reading, obviously not a novel or a newspaper reading, right? Reading means understanding the concept, understanding if a question is asked, how the answer is to be written, right? So that is the R for the reading, right? So P for preview, then Q for questions, then R for review. And then after that, S is for self-recite. So whatever you have read in the book right now probably you just, you know, shut down the book, you know, close the book or close your eyes and just try to recall, you know, whatever you have read in the book, right? So that is self-recite. So that is, you try to remember and see whether you've memorized it, try to recall it, whatever you have read in the book, right? Read in that particular chapter. So that is the self-recite, right? And then the last one is over there, PQRST. Then T over there stands for you test now. That whatever questions are there at the end of the chapter or whatever questions you had created out of the heading or the subheading, are you able to answer those questions? Right, so I thought maybe just let me share this, what I came to know about a study methodology for a theory subject called as the PQRST technique. Right, what does the PQRST stand for? P for preview, then Q for the question, then after that the R for the reading, S for the self-recite, and then the T for the testing, that whatever you have studied in the chapter, are you now able to answer the questions, right? So probably next time when you study a theory subject, you could use this method and then tell me your feedback that how effectively is it working for you or no. Okay, right, so now coming to CARO 2016, I think before I revise the chapter with you, already in the chat the chapter has been discussed, right? The applicability of CARO, okay, then after that the 16 clauses of CARO 2016, all has been discussed. Okay, right, not self-recite, okay, it is self-recite, R-E-C-I-T-E, somebody has written over there, you know, right? Amara, yes, Amar, you have written over there self-recites. It is not self-recites. It is self-recite, recitation. Like, you know, you recite a poem. Okay, so this is self-recitation. So whatever you have read in the book, whatever you remember, you have to recite it again. Say it again aloud. Okay, right. Right, and then they talk about the test. And obviously, yes, Bhavani Sandeep has mentioned, what about vitamin W? That though is our secret formula. No, right, so for us, then we will make it as PQRST plus W. that works best. No, now I think it's like a more comprehensive now. And so P, Q, R, S, T, then U cancel, V cancel, and then directly we go to W. That is the writing practice. Wonderful. Okay, right. So, you know, Jio Limited has taken a loan from the bank of 350, from the bank of 350 crore. Right, Jio Limited, a company has taken Jio Limited, so it's a public company. So is Karo applicable? Yes, Karo applicable. It has taken a loan from the bank of 350 crore. Right, first two installments of the loan, say it is repayable over 7 installments of 50 crore each. First two installments of 50 crore, it has been able to repay on or before the due date. However, third installment onwards, there has been a default in the repayment of the loan which has been taken from the bank. Right, as an auditor, how would you do the reporting for this? Jio Limited, I repeat the question, has taken a loan from the bank. Right, loan is of 350 crore. First two installments of the loan repaid on time. And now from third installment onwards, they are not able to repay. They are not repaying the bank loan on time. As an auditor, how would you report? Yes, which clause? Right, as an auditor, and where would you report for this default in the repayment of the loan? Right, clause 8, wonderful. Neeta Soni, you've replied first, but just you have written the number 8, so here it is fine. But in the exams, how the clauses of Karo are to be written? In small Roman, that is how Sneha Verma has written it, right? Clause 8 of Karo 2016. Right, so how do you start your answer? As per clause 8. Of para 3 of Karo 2016, an auditor is required to report whether a company has defaulted. Everybody with me? Right? As per clause 8 of para 3 of Karo 2016, an auditor is required to report whether the company has defaulted in the repayment of loans, right, or borrowings to banks, financial institutions, government, debenture holders. If yes, there has been a default in the repayment, then what does it say? The period and amount of default is to be reported. Right? For what period? Even a one-day default is required to be reported. And the amount. Amount includes both the principal as well as the interest portion. Right? So the period and amount of default is to be reported. And the second part of the reporting clause says that in case if the default is in the repayment of dues to banks, financial institutions and government, no debenture holders over here, only the first three, banks, financial institutions and the government, then lender-wise details are to be provided. Right? So this is the reporting requirement for the statutory auditor under clause 8 of CARO. Additionally, a company, the management, while preparing the financial statements as per Schedule 3, right, to the Companies Act, in the notes to account, the management is required to disclose the details of the terms of repayments of loan, right, and the interest and principal amount thereon, and the period and amount of continuing default, if any, in the repayment of such loans. Right, what is also a Schedule 3 requirement which you need to mention in your answer in this case? That the company, the management is required to disclose in the notes to account also the period and amount of continuing default in the repayment of the loans. Right, so management will disclose in the notes to account what the period and amount of continuing default as per Schedule 3 requirement. An auditor will report the same in his audit report under Clause 8 of CARO 2016. Right, so in the given case, Jio Limited has defaulted in the repayment of loan from third installment onwards, and hence the auditor is required to report on the same as per clause 8 of para 3 of CARO 2016. And the auditor should also ensure that management has made adequate disclosures as per Schedule 3 in the notes to account. Right, so management also, whether they have made the disclosures, auditor, you need to check for that. Right, is it clear to everyone? Clause 8 of para 3 of CARO 2016. Okay, right, next one, right, clause 16 of CARO 2016. Can anybody tell me what is clause 16? Yes, board report. Oh, no, why? Soumya Sari, why have you mentioned board report over there? Notes to account. No, why board's report? Right now I'm talking about the notes to account. There the management is required to disclose. Yes, I've asked you the next question. Tell me, right, clause 16 of CARO 2016, what is that regarding? RBI, okay, Bikki Didwania replied first, right? RBI, what about RBI? Registration with RBI. Right, so as per clause 16 of para 3 of CARO 2016, an auditor is required to report whether a company is required to be registered. Are you getting that? Whether a company is required to be registered under section 45IA of the RBI Act. If yes, whether the certificate of registration, whether the registration has been obtained. Right? Very important. Three times this question is there in the RTP. Wonderful. So many of you have replied. And RBI. But you know, section 45IA, let's learn to be specific. Right? NBFC, section 45, RBI regulation. Okay. Wonderful. Wonderful. Right, so what is the reporting requirement under clause 16? Right, whether a company is required to be registered under section 45IA of the RBI Act 1934. If yes, whether the registration has been obtained. Right, those of you who've already studied the classes for CARO, you know that CARO, we always need to look into it from two perspectives. One, what is the reporting requirement? So what I just discussed with you, that is the reporting requirement. If it is required to be registered, whether the registration has been obtained. And the second part, which is to be coming in your answers, is the audit procedure. Okay, as an auditor, when I need to report on this, right, okay, whether the company is required to be registered and whether the registration has been obtained. As an auditor, what checking is to be done by the auditor is also what I need to write in my answer, that is the audit procedures. Like if you look into our textbook, you know, you see that the clause reporting requirement is given and then some explanation is given. What is that explanation about, right? The explanation is regarding the audit procedures. Right, so when is a company required to be registered under section 45IA of the RBI Act? Right, for that you need to look into the activities in which the company is engaged into, whether they are included in the list of activities mentioned under section 45IA. What are examples of few of the activities listed under section 45IA? Right, asset finance company, leasing company, hire purchase finance company, mortgage guarantee company, right, all varieties of NBFCs, non-banking financial companies, right, non-banking financial activities. Right, so first, what is the point? Audit procedure. You need to check that the activities which are being conducted by the company, are they covered in the list mentioned under section 45IA? Right, then second one, what does it say? At least 50% of the income of that NBFC should be income from financial assets, and at least 50% of its total assets should be financial assets. Right, so that's the second one, 50% requirement. This is also coming in your MCQ, this 50% point. Okay, total revenue, total, you know, assets or income of the company are 100 crore, and out of that 40 crore is coming from the financial assets. Then they are not complying with the requirement of 50%. Because if total income is 100 crore and income from financial assets is 40 crore, it is not more than 50%. Say, had it been 60 crore, then it would have been more than 50%. Right. So, what? Yes, are you all paying attention to me? Right. Listen to me carefully. What is the first point over there? Whether the activities covered, you know, are they covered in the list of activities mentioned under section 45IA? Second one, at least 50% of the income is the income from financial assets, and 50% of the total assets is again the financial assets. Right. Third one, whether the company has complied with the net owned fund requirement. Right, whether the NBFC has complied with the net owned fund requirement, right, minimum net owned fund requirement, whether it has been complied with. Once these three conditions are fulfilled, then it says now you require registration with RBI, right, and then auditor, you need to inquire whether the certificate of registration has been obtained, and if not, then the reasons as to why it has not been obtained. Right, so I've discussed with you, okay, what is the reporting requirement and what are the four audit procedures for clause 16 of CARO 2016. What are the four reporting audit procedures? List of activities, 50% income, 50% assets, net owned fund requirement, and whether the COR, the certificate of registration, whether it has been obtained. And if not, then the reasons as to why it has not been obtained. You need to get those reasons from the management and do the documentation of the same. Right, good for everyone. Okay. Right, you know, Jio Limited, they purchased an immovable property, right? We just take simple example, Jio Limited, always name of our entity, right? So Jio Limited, they purchased an immovable property, okay? But that immovable property, they got it registered in the name of the director of the company. Yes, Jio Limited purchased land, building, and immovable property they purchased, and now they got it registered under the, right? They got it registered in the name of the director of the company, the promoter of the company, rather than in the name of the company. Right? As an auditor, tell me specifically under which clause of CARO will you do the reporting? Right? Clause 1, but I've already told you I want specifically. Clause 1 mein what aage? What next? Clause 1, yes, Vignesh, Sai Pavan, Madhavi, yes, title deed 1C, yes, Gokulandan, you've replied, 1C. Right? Clause 1C of Para 3 of CARO 2016. What does it say? As per Clause 1C of Para 3 of CARO 2016, an auditor is required to report what? An auditor is required to report what? Whether the, yes, whether the title deeds of immovable properties are they held in the name of the company. If not, provide the details thereof. Right? What is the reporting requirement under 1C of CARO 2016? Whether title deeds of immovable properties are they held in the name of the company. If not, provide the details thereof. Okay, this is the reporting requirement. Now we will look into the audit procedures. Right, what are the audit procedures? Now, what does it say? Title deeds of immovable properties. So can you think of examples of title deeds from where I can come to know that the immovable property is in the name of the company? Right, it could be the sales deed, the conveyance deed, the transfer deed, the lease deed. Right, or any other document which tells you that this owner, the ownership is of the company. Right, the registered sales deed, conveyance deed, transfer deed, lease deed. Right, so what is that? Title deeds of immovable property. So auditor should verify the title documents. Right, second is list the title documents. He should reconcile the same with the immovable properties in the fixed assets register. Right, so if you look into the fixed assets register, you see that the company has 20 land and 50 buildings. Right, so all those 20 land and 50 buildings, you need to verify the title deed and check whether it is in the name of the company. Is everybody understanding the audit procedure? Yes, are you understanding the audit procedure? Okay, right, so one, verify the title deed, the title documents. Second one, I said reconcile with the fixed assets register. Then, you know, over there in the audit procedures, they talk about different possibilities. That sometimes there could be a situation where a firm or an LLP is converted into a company. In that case, the property might be in the name, the immovable property might be in the name of the firm or the LLP. Right, so you need to give the explanation for the same as conversion has been done. Another situation that there could be an amalgamation which has taken place during the year, and that is why again the immovable property might be in the name of the earlier entity. Okay, so one, I talked about the conversion of the entity. Second, I talked about the amalgamation of the entity. Third one, that sometimes against the property, a loan could have been taken. The property could have been mortgaged with any bank or financial institution for any loan. So in that case, the property title deed is going to be in the name of the bank or the financial institution till the time that loan is outstanding. So in that case, the auditor should obtain a confirmation from that bank financial institution that yes, that the property has been mortgaged with us for so and so loan taken by the company. Are you understanding? So that is mortgage, you know, mortgage of property with any bank financial institution. Then sometimes there could be a situation where the property title deed is lost or accidentally destroyed or so. Right, so in that case, you need to make the inquiries of the management, and if it is lost, you also need to check the copy of the FIR which would have been filed for the same. Right, there could also be a situation that there could be a dispute regarding the ownership of the property. You know, two brothers, Ram and Lakhan, both of them are saying, no, my property. Yes, Karan Arjun saying, no, my property. Right, so there could be a dispute regarding the ownership of the property. Right, so in that case, again, you need to discuss with the management and make a suitable mention of it in your audit report. Right, so these are the audit procedures. Okay, right, so in my question right now, what did I say? Jio Limited purchased an immovable property, but it is in the name of the director of the company. Right, so first you'll write as per clause 1C of para 3 of CARO 2016, an auditor is required to report whether title deeds of immovable properties are held in the name of the company. If not, provide the details thereof. Right? The auditor should verify the title documents. He should reconcile the same with the fixed assets register. right? That to check whether they are held in the name of the company. In the given case, it is held in the name of the director of the company, which is now required to be reported under clause 1C of para 3 of CARO 2016. Right, everybody, are you understanding that? Title deeds of immovable properties, very important one. Okay, right, what is clause 6 of para 3 of CARO 2016? Are you all paying attention? Yes. Charge against loan, detailed discussion with management, wonderful, wonderful, right? Court application, okay, right? Yes, would you tell me what is clause 6, easy one, of para 3 of CARO 2016, right? Verify title deed, okay. Yes, cost records. Wonderful. Yes, yes, Jakotia. Yes, it is cost records. What does it say? Well, maintenance of cost records have been prescribed by the central government under section 148(1) of the Companies Act 2013. Whether such cost records have been made and maintained. Two words over there. Made, the two keywords. Made and maintained. Right, what is the reporting requirement under clause 6 of CARO 2016, where the maintenance of cost records has been prescribed by the central government under section 148(1), whether such cost records have been made and maintained. Right, so statutory auditor of the company, you also need to go through the cost records of the company and comment in CARO that whether such cost records have been made and maintained. Right, so that is the reporting requirement. Now let us come to the audit procedures. Right, what do you mean by cost records? Right, we know books of account is what? Cash book, trading account, balance sheet. Right, and what is the fourth one? If prescribed by central government, the cost records. So what do you mean by cost records over there? Right, cost records, SCMPE, right, your costing. What is cost records? Right, three things in life, no? Material, labor, overheads, other items of cost. Right, which give the details of the material, labor and the other items of cost. So other items of cost is nothing but the overheads. Right, so cost records where they have been prescribed by the central government, whether such cost records giving the details of utilization of material, labor and other items of cost have been maintained. Statutory auditor, are you required to do a detailed examination of those cost records? Are you required to do almost like a cost audit, true and fair view of cost of production? Are you required to express an opinion? No, 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 no. Right? You just have to do a general review, an overview of the cost records of the company, not a detailed examination. You only have to do a general review of the cost records being maintained by the entity. Right? Then another, are you required to report on cost audit? Under clause 6 of CARO, are you required to report where cost audit is required to be done and it has not been done? Are you required to report on cost audit? No, there is nothing mentioned over there. Right? So you are not required to mention about where a cost audit has been ordered by the central government but it has not been conducted by the entity. No reporting on cost audit. The reporting is only on the cost record. Right, so what do you mean by cost records? Material, labor, other items of cost. Do you need to do a detailed examination of the cost records? No, only a general overview. Right, only a general overview. Overall, prima facie, you need to check whether the cost records have been made and maintained. And do you need to comment on the cost audit where it is applicable to the entity? No comment on the cost audit where it is ordered and not conducted or it is whatever. No reporting on the cost audit. The reporting under CARO is only for the cost records. Are you getting that clearly? Right, anyways, I have touched upon the concept of cost audit. Right, so just quickly tell me what is the exemption from cost audit, very important question nowadays. Right, only cost records, wonderful. Okay, yes, right, you're continuing to sitting straight, huh? I'm assuming that every time I can't tell you that. Okay, so no, you know, spine in any other direction other than a 90 degree direction, huh? Sit straight. Okay, right, yes, tell me cost audit, exemption from cost audit. Yes, exemption from cost audit. Oh, why statutory dues? Clause 7, okay. If come to that, I'll come to that. Wait, wait. Right, somebody has mentioned captive consumption, SEZ, okay, or 75% forex. Wonderful. Right, so what is the exemption from cost audit? If more than 75% revenue is generated from exports through foreign exchange, no cost audit required to be done. I'm not talking about cost records now. I'm talking about the exemption from cost audit. Right, so if more than 75% revenue is coming from exports in foreign exchange, no cost audit applicable, no exemption from cost audit. Second, if it is operating in an SEZ, no limits, directly cost audit not applicable. Right, operating in an SEZ, or what does it say, is engaged in the generation of electricity through a captive generating plant for captive consumption. Right, or an entity which is engaged in the generation of electricity for captive consumption through a captive generating plant. Right, that is the exemption from the cost audit. Okay, right, very important over there. Right, so what are the 3 points for exemption from cost audit? Revenue from exports is more than 75% of the total revenue in foreign exchange, operating in an SEZ, or is engaged in the generation of electricity for captive consumption through a captive generating plant. Okay. Right, next one. Let me come to clause 5 of para 3 of CARO 2016. What is clause 5? Yes, what is clause 5? Wonderful. Right, so many of you writing the answer. Sadhu Sampath, yes. Akshay Jairam, right. SEZ, okay. Right, what is clause 5? You should have the early bird advantage, no? You should be the first one to reply. Right? What is clause 5 of para 3 of CARO 2016? 75 se zyada export. Oh my God. Now, how will you interpret that in the exam into English? Okay, public deposits. Yes, deposits from public. Wonderful. Now the flow of those points is coming. Deposits, deposits, deposits. Okay, my chat is filled with deposits now. Wonderful. Right, so what is clause 5? It is regarding the deposits from public. Right, so as per clause 5, right, I'm assuming you're paying attention, huh? Okay, as per clause 5 of para 3 of CARO 2016, an auditor is required to report whether the company has accepted deposits. Right, whether if it has not accepted deposits, most of the companies it says as the company has not accepted deposits, reporting under clause 5 is not applicable. Right, auditor would report that way. So whether the company has accepted deposits from the public, then yes, whether the provisions of section 73 to section 76 of the Companies Act 2013 and any other relevant provisions have been complied with, the rules framed there under, that is the company's acceptance of deposit rules, right, the RBI directives. Right, so point one, whether the company has accepted deposits. If yes, then whether it has complied with section 73 to section 76 and any other relevant provisions of the Companies Act, the rules framed there under the RBI directives. So whether it has complied with these three, and if not complied with these three, then what does it say? State the nature of the contravention. Right? Then in that case, you need to state the nature of the contravention regarding which of these have not been complied with. And any order passed by whom? NCLT, CLB, RBI, court, tribunal, at least whether that order has been complied with or not. So you've not complied with the provision, that means there is a contravention. So state the nature of the contravention. And when there is a contravention, there could be an order passed. Right, so if there is an order passed by NCLT, CLB, RBI, court or tribunal, at least whether that order has been complied with or not. Right, at least whether that order has been complied with or not. Right, so what is clause 5? Whether the company has accepted deposits. If yes, whether it has complied with provisions of Companies Act, the rules framed there under the RBI directives. If not complied, then state the nature of the contravention and any order passed by NCLT, CLB, RBI, court, tribunal, at least whether that order has been complied with or not. Right, so as an auditor, I need to understand from the management their system for accepting deposits, their internal control system through which they are tracking regarding what is the due date for the repayment of deposits and whether they are being repaid on or before the due date. Right, I need to check the efficacy of the system being used by the management. I need to check the effectiveness of the internal controls being used by the management for the repayment of deposits on or before the due date. then also whether they have a proper system for acceptance of the deposits, right? And if there is a contravention, make inquiries of the management regarding the nature of the contravention. Also ask management whether any orders have been received, and if they have been received, whether the same have been complied with or not. Right? Is that clear to everyone? Right. Now coming to Nidhi Company. Right? You'll tell me Nidhi Company, which clause? Right? Nidhi Company. Right? Now coming to the next one. Right? Company accepted deposits. Okay. Vinod Kumar. Okay. Then Maitri Nandan deposits. Okay. Wonderful. Now tell me next one. Yes. Nidhi Company, which clause? Nidhi Company. Okay. All these are there in Karo 2020 also. All these clauses. Only like Karo 2020 is a higher version. Wonderful. Yes, Jakotia. Right? Clause 12. Even like the early bird advantage. Always first. Wonderful. I hope in rank also, in marks also, you should come first. Okay. Rather, I want every one of you, mainly now in July 20, that you should get 20 more marks than originally what you are, you know, deserving to get. Like say, generally, if your capacity is to get 40 marks, now you should get 60 marks. Why? Because 3 months bonus time, yaar. Agar ye nahi kiya, toh life mein kya kiya fir? And if you don't get that bonus, only 20, not, I should not say only, I know it's very painful, but then you should get some extra marks. No, I just think, you know, can now instead of May, when the attempt is in July, will it so happen that the passing percentage for CA final will increase to 40% or something like that? Just a vague thought which came to my mind, because, you know, if all of you continue to study, but looking at the response to the live session, it looks like that you are all studying, but then that should also be seen in the results which will be declared by ICAI. Okay, right? So now you keep a target. Whatever was your original target, now you do plus 20. If you targeted, you will get 60 marks in audit, exemption in audit. Now it has to be 80 in audit. Okay. Right. Let's come to clause 12. Right. What is clause 12? It is regarding the Nidhi Company. Whether the Nidhi Company has complied with the requirement of net owned funds to deposits in the ratio of 1:20 to meet out the liability. Right, what are the 2 points the auditor is required to report in case of a Nidhi Company? Whether the Nidhi Company has complied with the requirement of net owned funds to deposits in the ratio of 1:20 to meet out the liability, and at least 10% of its investments of the Nidhi Company is in the unencumbered term deposits, again to meet out the liability. So as an auditor, what are the 2 points on which you need to do the reporting in case of a Nidhi Company? Right, net owned funds to deposits in the ratio of 1:20 to meet out the liability. And second one, at least 10% of its investments is in the unencumbered term deposits to meet out the liability. Right, so net owned funds to deposits in the ratio of 1:20. Right, so if their net worth is 1 crore, deposit should not be more than 20 crore. That is what you mean by net owned funds to deposits in the ratio of 1:20. Right, so you need to ask the management to provide you with the computation. Right, you need to ask the management to provide you with the computation. Right, then what will you check? Net owned funds. How do you calculate the net owned funds of a Nidhi Company? Equity share capital plus free reserves minus accumulated losses minus intangible assets. Preference share capital not to be considered. Are you all with me? Equity share capital plus free reserves minus the, yes, intangible assets and the accumulated losses. That will give you the net owned funds of the Nidhi Company. And that divided, that is to the deposits. And deposits, fixed deposit, recurring deposit and the saving deposit. Right? So you need to take the total of the total fixed deposit, fair savings and the recurring deposits which have been kept by the Nidhi, with the Nidhi Company. And that ratio should not exceed 1:20. It should be maintained at 1:20. Right? So net owned funds and also the deposits. You need to check what is included in the amount of net owned funds and while calculating the amount of the deposit liability. And at least 10% of its investments in the unencumbered term deposits. Unencumbered means free of any charge. That has not been given as a loan taken against those. That's not given as a security for any loan taken by the Nidhi Company. And unencumbered, that means free of any charge. Right, so at least 10% of its investments is in the unencumbered term deposits to meet out the liability. Right, so that is regarding the clause 12, which is regarding the Nidhi company. Okay, now Mio Limited, Jio Limited we've done, now Mio Limited. Okay, Mio Limited has a lot of employees, say some 5,000 employees working in their organization. And you know, the provident fund, employee contribution, employer contribution to the provident fund is required to be done on a monthly basis on or before the due date. Right, so say their PF contribution for this month, the amount is coming to 5 crore, just as an example. Right, what is the liability of provident fund, say, which is coming for Jio Limited in this month? 5 crore. Okay, and on or before the due date, Jio Limited has only paid 4 crore out of it. Right, so what was their liability? 5 crore. How much have they paid out of it to the provident, to the PF trust or so, or to the authorities? Only 4 crore. As an auditor, how would you report? Right, wonderful. Clause 7A, Manoj Reddy, right? That's more specific. Right, Gokulandan, it's not clause 8. Clause 8 is what? Repayment of dues. Now, we started with clause 8 only. So, we are talking about clause 7, which is regarding the current accounts not allowed. Naveen Chand, yes, current accounts, what are you saying? Okay. Right, so we are talking about the clause 7 of para 3 of CARO 2016, which is regarding the statutory dues, one of the very favorite clauses from CARO for the institute. Right, questions being asked by the institute. Right, so whether the company, now clause 7A, and you also have the clause 7B. Right, what is clause 7A? Whether the company is regular. Right, so here you have to comment on the regularity of the payment of the undisputed statutory dues. Right, so whether the company is regular in depositing the undisputed statutory dues, including income tax, sales tax, VAT, GST, cess, right, or any other such statutory dues, right, with the governmental authorities on or before the due date, and all those undisputed statutory dues which are outstanding as on the date of the balance sheet for a period of more than 6 months from the date they became payable. Right, so clause 7A requires reporting on two things. One, the regularity of payment of the undisputed statutory dues, right? And second one, those which are outstanding, undisputed, which are outstanding as on the date of the balance sheet for a period of more than 6 months from the date they became payable. Right, so undisputed, but it is outstanding for more than 6 months from the date it became payable. Right, so that means all statutory dues which are outstanding on or before 30th of September of that financial year. Because say since 30th of July 2019, company had to pay the provident fund. And now it is say 31st March 2020. Right, so since July they had to pay. So August, September, October, November, December, January, February, March. Is it more than 6 months? Yes. Right, so it could be many previous years also. More than 6 months, undisputed statutory dues, you need to do the reporting under clause 7A of CARO 2016. Right, so 7A, what are the 2 points? Regularity of payment and more than 6 months. Okay, then clause 7B, which is regarding the disputed statutory dues. Right, where the dues have not been deposited in the with the government on account of any dispute. That means we are not now talking about the disputed statutory dues. In that case, what is the reporting which is required to be done by the auditor? The amount, right? The estimated amount involved and the forum where the dispute is pending, right? So what is the amount of dispute going on and where is the dispute right now? Supreme Court, High Court, CESTAT, CIT, DCIT, right? Where is the dispute right now? At which forum? And then there is a sentence given over there in the paragraph, a mere representation to the department does not constitute a dispute. Why? Because the company needs to go into appeal for it to become a disputed statutory due. Right, so for disputed statutory dues, what are the 2 points of reporting? One, the amount involved. Okay, what is the amount of dispute? It's like, you know, you are saying you have to pay service tax of 10 crore and department is saying, no, you have to pay service tax of 18 crore. Right, so that's the amount involved in the dispute and the forum where the dispute is pending, and a mere representation to the department does not constitute a dispute. Right, coming back to my question, I told you Mio Limited had to pay provident fund of 5 crore but they only paid of 4 crore. So as an auditor, where do you need to report? Right, everybody with me? Right, when such a question is asked regarding the statutory dues in the exam, from the suggested of ICAI, what I have noticed is that they don't directly go to as per clause 7 of CARO 2016. है ना, वेयर डू दे स्टार्ट विथ. नाउ लिसन टू मी केयरफुली, इफ यू हैव अ पेन एंड पेपर इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू, यू कैन कीप ऑन मेकिंग अ नोट ऑफ द पॉइंट्स, राइट. यू नीड टू स्टार्ट विथ एज पर एसए 250, consideration of laws and regulations in an audit of financial statements. The primary responsibility for the compliance with the laws and regulations rests with the management, because provident fund, it's a law, no, it's a statutory due, so obviously it is bound by some law, right. So for all statutory dues, this is the standard template of what we need to write in the answer, right. So as per SA 250, the primary responsibility for the compliance with the laws and regulations rests with the management. Auditor's objective, as per SA 200, the overall objective of the auditor is to obtain a reasonable assurance that financial statements are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or error. I know this sentence is like in your DNA. Okay, right. So reasonable assurance that financial statements are free from material misstatement, whether due to fraud or error. Full stop. Don't write full stop, draw up, make a dot. Okay, right. Due to the inherent limitations of an audit, right. Third sentence, first sentence I told you 250, second 200 ka first sentence, overall objective. Second sentence, due to the inherent limitations of an audit, there is an unavoidable risk. What did I say? Due to the inherent limitations of an audit, there is an unavoidable risk that some material misstatements may not be detected. Right? Some material misstatements may not be detected, even though if the audit has been planned and performed in accordance with the standards on auditing. Right, then SA 705, then after 200 ka two sentence over, fourth sentence which we go to, as per SA 705, if during the course of audit, the auditor identifies instances of non-compliances with the laws and regulation, he is required to modify his opinion. Right, so during the audit, if you find out any instances of non-compliance, you need to report, yes, report the non-compliance in accordance with SA 705 by way of modifying your opinion. Right, so that is first from the standards 250, 200, 705. Now, as per section 128 of the Companies Act 2013, a company shall be considered to be maintaining proper books of account if they give a true and fair view and are kept under the double entry system of accounting and the accrual basis of accounting. What is important for me over here is the accrual basis of accounting. So statutory dues, you know, you don't need to account for it in your books of account of a company when you pay it. You have to account for it whenever it is due, because you have to follow the accrual basis of accounting and not the cash system of accounting, because cash system is not allowed under the Companies Act 2013. Right? Only mercantile system, accrual basis of accounting is allowed. Right? So as per section 128 of the Companies Act 2013, a company shall be considered to be maintaining proper books of account if they give a true and fair view and are kept as per the accrual basis and the double entry system of accounting. Right, then next one, as per section 43B of the Income Tax Act 1961. So now first we did some standards, we mentioned some standards, then we went to section 128 of Companies Act. Now we are talking about as per section 43B of the Income Tax Act 1961. Right, certain deductions are allowed only on actual payment basis. We call them as the 43B payments only. Right, certain deductions are allowed only on actual payment basis, and statutory dues is one of those. So under Income Tax Act, you get deduction for a statutory due only on the payment basis. Then after mentioning the standard and Companies Act and Income Tax Act, next now you say as per Clause 7A or as per Clause 7B of CARO 2016, depending upon whether the question is on the undisputed statutory due, disputed statutory due, or both. You're listening to me, right? Right, so now you need to mention the, depending upon what the question is on, undisputed, disputed, right, the Clause 7A, Clause 7B, or both. Then you write down in the given case what has happened, right? The company was required to pay PF of 5 crore. However, due to financial crunch, the company has been able to pay only an amount of 4 crore, right? You could yes, you mentioned that. And hence, the auditor is required to report the same as per Clause 7A of CARO 2016, that the company is not regular in depositing the undisputed statutory dues. And this does not look to me a situation of more than 6 months, because I told you that month they have not paid. They have not specified the time period, right? So that is why that more than 6 months will not come over here. But sometimes in the case study over here, they also say that, you know, income tax appeal has been filed by the company for an amount of 150 crore. Right? So that comes under the disputed statutory dues, where it is the amount involved and the forum where the dispute is pending is required to be mentioned. Right? Is everybody understanding clause 7 of CARO 2016? What is clause 7? Right? It is regarding the statutory dues. Right, next one. Let's come to clause 13. Right, opening ceremony awaited. Webhav Gaming, okay, value added now. Okay, Neha Joshi has put her hands up. What happened, Neha? Okay, disallowed. When they ask for 4 marks, do we need to mention all the points you said now? Yes. Right, but in a brief manner. What if asked specifically on CARO? Right, specifically on CARO, still this is the background which you need to give in your answer. 250, 200, 705, 128. Yes, as Komati Sarasi, you've mentioned it correctly, the list entirely. Okay, RPT. Yes, related parties. So now I've got the answer for the clause 13, which is regarding the related parties, right? So we've seen question 2 times, right? To be asked in the exams from, put in the RTP from related parties, yet to be asked in the exam. Right, so related parties, clause 13, 2 to 3 times I've seen a question in the RTP on this one. Right, related parties as per clause 13 of para 3 of CARO 2016, an auditor is required to report whether the transactions with the related parties, so now though it is one clause, it has 2 parts in it. Whether the transactions with the related parties are in compliance with section 177 and 188 of the Companies Act 2013, and the details of these transactions, have they been, the details of the related parties and the transaction, have they been disclosed in accordance with the applicable accounting standards? Right, so what is the reporting requirement under clause 13 of CARO 2016? Whether the transactions with the related parties, are they in compliance with section 177 and 188? And whether the details have been disclosed in accordance with the applicable accounting standards. Can anybody tell me what would be the applicable accounting standards over here? Right, AS 18 and IND AS 24. Right, AS 18 or the IND AS 24. Right, so whether the transactions are in compliance with the provisions of section 177 and 188, 177 audit committee, right, so whether audit committee approval has been obtained for the related party transaction, and 188 related party transaction, which gives the definition of what would constitute a related party transaction, right, so whether it is in compliance with section 177 and 188, right, and then whether the details have been disclosed in accordance with the applicable accounting standards. Right, so in your audit procedures for this clause 13 of CARO 2016, you need to write down the audit procedures of SA 550, which is regarding the related parties. Right, we had discussed on the day when we were discussing the standards on auditing, what are the records and documents which will help the auditor to identify the related parties. Right, so the income tax return, shareholders register, confirmations from the bank, minutes of the meeting, last year working paper. Right, so few points regarding the audit procedures to identify the related parties. Then after that, auditor also needs to verify whether the related party transactions are in the ordinary course of business. Right, so ordinary course of business is one more audit procedure. Third one, whether the related party transactions are the arm's length transaction. Right, so ordinary course of business, then arm's length transaction, yes, whether it's an arm's length transaction, then you can go through the minutes of the meeting, you can have a discussion with the management board of directors regarding related party transaction, and you can also check whether the compliance, the disclosures have been given as per the requirements of AS 18 and IND AS 24. Right, so one important takeaway which I want you to keep in your mind whenever you study CARO is regarding you need to keep 2 dimensions. It has to be a 2-dimensional study. One, what is the reporting requirement? And second, what are the audit procedures? Okay, right. A Private Limited is a subsidiary of a listed entity having a turnover of 7 crore. Is CARO applicable? Right, next question. I've discussed with you clause 13. Now I'm coming to the Next question. A private limited is a subsidiary of a listed entity having a turnover of only rupees 7 crore. Is CARO applicable or not applicable? Omnibus approval, okay. A private limited is a subsidiary of a listed entity having a turnover of 7 crore. Is CARO applicable or is CARO not applicable? No? Yes? Shrishti Kala is saying yes and then Neeta Soni is saying no. So you both are into like, you know, differences of opinion. Okay, SA-299. Hai na? So the joint auditors having a separate opinion may report separately, not bound by the views of the majority of the joint auditors. And each of the joint auditor can make a reference to the other joint auditor's report in his audit report. Okay, anyways. Yes, so yes, it is applicable as it is a subsidiary of a public company. Wonderful, right? So for the question which I asked you right now, is CARO applicable to a private limited? Yes. Right, because what did I say? A private limited is a subsidiary of a listed entity. Subsidiary of a listed entity, that means the holding company is a public company. So where holding is a public company or a subsidiary is a public company of a private company, to that private company CARO is always applicable. Right, so in that case I don't need to check the limit of paid up share capital reserves and surplus and the borrowings and the turnover, right, the revenue. Right, though what I mentioned in my question was that revenue is only 7 crore. What is the revenue required for applicability of CARO for a private limited company? 10 crore. Right, but in this case, a private limited is a subsidiary of a listed entity having a turnover of 7 crore. Is CARO applicable? Yes, CARO applicable because it is a subsidiary of a public company. Right, so let's come to the discussion on the applicability of CARO 2016. Right, so whenever a question regarding the applicability of CARO comes in the exam, right, you could start your answer saying that CARO 2016 is an additional reporting requirement order. Are you all with me? CARO 2016 is an additional reporting requirement order which has been issued by the central government in consultation with ICAI under section 143(11) of the Companies Act 2013. This is the opening remark which you could make in your answer. What is the opening remark? Yes, CARO 2016 is an additional reporting requirement order which has been issued by the central government in consultation with ICAI under section 143(11) of the Companies Act 2013. Right, the order states that it will be applicable to every company including a foreign company except a banking company registered under the Banking Regulation Act, insurance company as defined under the Insurance Act, right, Section 8 company, a company licensed to operate under Section 8 of the Companies Act, one person company and a small company, and a private limited company, what did I say, shall apply to every company including a foreign company except banking company, insurance company, Section 8 company, one person company, small company. So to these five companies, CARO never applicable. And a private limited company subject to certain conditions for CARO not to be applicable. What are those conditions? A private limited company not being a subsidiary or a holding of a public company. So if the subsidiary or holding is a public company, then to that private company, CARO applicable, as in the case study which I told you about. Right. So private limited company not being a subsidiary or a holding of a public company, having paid up share capital and reserves and surplus not exceeding 1 crore as on the balance sheet date, and total borrowings from banks or financial institutions not exceeding 1 crore during the financial year, and total revenue as disclosed in Schedule 3 including the revenue from discontinuing operations not exceeding 10 crore during the financial year. Right, those of you who have not yet done the writing practice for the applicability of CARO, make it a point that today you write down the entire answer for the applicability of CARO. Right, starting right from this applies to, CARO is an additional reporting requirement order up to the 10 crore during the financial year. Right, so you write down the entire provision. Then in the given case, what has happened? Right, A Private Limited is a subsidiary of a listed entity having a turnover of 7 crore. So though the turnover is below the prescribed limit of 10 crore, it is a subsidiary of a listed entity. That is, means it is a, the holding company is a public company, and hence reporting of Karo, reporting under Karo is applicable to A Private Limited. Right, reporting under Karo would be applicable to A Private Limited. Is that clear to everyone? Right, debit balance in profit and loss account, right, negative reserves, are they also to be considered while calculating the paid up capital and reserves and surplus? Debit balance in profit and loss account, negative reserves and surplus, should I reduce it from my amount of paid up capital and reserves and surplus? Yes, even that is required to be considered, always to be considered. Debit balance in profit and loss account should always be reduced from the reserves and surplus, that is the other equity. Right, you need to reduce it from the other equity, right, the debit balance in the profit and loss account. So negative reserve surplus is also to be considered while calculating the paid up capital and reserves and surplus of 1 crore. Right, borrowings from banks, financial institutions, is it per bank financial institution 1 crore or all banks financial institutions put together 1 crore? Right, it is all bank financial institutions put together 1 crore. Right, all banks finance, is it only for the long term loans or also for the current loans like the CC overdraft? Should that also be considered while calculating the limit of 1 crore? Right, it is for both the long term also and the current also. So even CC overdraft, packing credit, yes, bills discounted, even those are to be considered while calculating the limit of 1 crore. Right, even those are to be considered while calculating the limit of 1 crore. Right, so if we summarize, you know, what are the 16 clauses of Karo 2016, right, we have clause 1, which is regarding the fixed assets, right, what is the reporting requirement, whether the company is maintaining the, yes, are you all with me, we are just summarizing the 16 clauses of Karo 2016, right, so whether the company is maintaining the proper records, right, showing full particulars, including quantitative details and the situation of fixed assets, whether these fixed assets have been physically verified by the management at reasonable intervals, and any material discrepancies noticed on physical verification, have they been properly dealt with in the books of account? 1C, whether title deeds of immovable properties, are they held in the name of the company? If not, provide the details thereof. Right, then clause 2, which is regarding the inventories. Whether inventories have been physically verified by the management at reasonable intervals, and any material discrepancies noticed on physical verification, have they been properly dealt with in the books of account? Clause 3, which is regarding the loans to Section 189 parties, right? Whether the company has granted any loan, right? Then what does it say? The terms and conditions thereof, whether they are prejudicial. Then if it is overdue, state the amount which is overdue for more than 90 days and reasonable steps taken for recovery of principal and interest. Then clause 4, which is regarding the LIGS, loans, investments, guarantees, securities, right? LIGS, whether they are in compliance with the provisions of section 185 and 186 of the Companies Act. Clause 5 is deposits from public, which we've already discussed. Clause 6 is regarding the cost records, right? Clause 7 is regarding the statutory dues. Clause 8, repayment of dues. Clause 9, end use of monies raised. Right, whether money raised by IPO, FPO, including debt instruments or term loans, have they been applied for the purpose for which they have been obtained? Right, if not, the details along with the delays or the defaults and the subsequent rectification, if any. Right, then after that we have clause 10, which is regarding the fraud. Whether any fraud on the company or any fraud by the company, by its officers or employees, noticed or reported during the year, if yes, the nature and amount involved is to be reported. Right, then clause 11, which is regarding the managerial remuneration. Right, whether managerial remuneration has been paid or provided for, right, in accordance with the provisions of section 197, read with schedule 5. If not, state the amount involved and the steps taken by the company for securing refund of the same. 12, Nidhi company, we've already discussed. 13, related parties, we've already discussed that. 14, preferential allotment. Right, whether any preferential allotment or private placement of shares or fully or partly convertible debentures have been done during the year, whether it is in compliance with section 42 of the Companies Act and whether it has been used for the purpose for which it has been raised. If not, state the amount involved and the nature of the non-compliance. Right? Clause 15, which is regarding the non-cash transaction. Right? Whether the company has entered into any non-cash transaction and whether it is in compliance with Section 192 of the Companies Act. And the last one over there, Clause 16, which is regarding the registration with RBI, which we've already revised. Right? So again, what is your, what you say, priority for today? Right, that you will look into the entire case studies, you know, question bank of CARO, and also write down one answer for the applicability of CARO and say one or two from the clauses of CARO. Right, clear to everyone? Okay, and again, what I discussed with you in the beginning, maybe you can try adopting that methodology and tell me how did you find it. Right, the methodology to study a theory subject called as the PQRST, and then we also added a W over there. Right, so the P stands for preview. Right, then the Q stands for the question, R stands for reading, then the S stands for the self-recite, and then the T stands over there for the test, and last one, then you do the writing practice, right? So PQRSTW. Okay, right, so tomorrow our revision is planned for the chapter of the tax audit, right, the form 3CD. Right, and 11:30 today we have the inter audit revision starting. Right, so again, somebody has asked in the chat, you know, that whether we should also attend that. Certainly, it will improve the quality of your answers. Any your audit terminology and your basic concepts, somewhere you would have missed out. Yes, you can certainly revise it over there. Right, so I see you all tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. Yes, wonderful.